गुड आफ्टरनून. द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज ऑब्जेक्टिविटी एंड प्रैक्टिकलिटी. वी ऑलरेडी सीन दिस अर्लियर, सो लेट मी टेल यू अगेन. ऑब्जेक्टिविटी इज़ वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट्स दैट वी नीड टू फाइंड इन अ रिसर्च टूल. ओके, सो वी हैव टू बी वेरी ऑब्जेक्टिव इन रिसर्च. सो द टूल वी सेलेक्ट ऑल्सो हैज़ टू बी ऑब्जेक्टिव. सो commonly what happens is whenever a researcher does research, there is bias. Bias means without your knowledge you do not take the correct answer because of various reasons. As a researcher you may have likes and dislikes, you may want certain things as outcome in your research. So these are all factors which cause bias in the researcher. So as we saw earlier, one way of controlling for bias is by being very objective in your research. So one of the tools that you can use is questionnaire. So in a questionnaire, if you have questions which ask whether a statement is true or false, yes or no, these are very objective. So you, there is no other way of interpreting. No means no, yes means yes. Okay, so there is no different way of interpreting such answers, such objective answers. Okay, so this is why objectivity is very important in a research tool. So if you ask a question to a patient saying, do you smoke or do you not smoke? So there are only two answers for it: yes, I smoke, or no, I do not smoke. The patient cannot say, I only smoke one cigarette a day. That means he smokes. So the answer will be yes. So this is how objectivity helps in your research. Even though there are chances of bias, we control all that by being objective in the way we question. So sometimes the researcher, if you do not want a patient outcome as smoking causes cancer, what you will do is you will have your own personal bias and that will cloud your judgment. So you will not be right in judging the answer that is given by a patient. So if you may think the patient smokes only one cigarette a day, so it may not cause cancer. So you, in your research outcome, you will say those who smoke less than two cigarettes a day, they cannot get cancer, and only those who smoke more than one packet, they are likely to get affected by cancer. So these are ways in which we can misinterpret what the patient or a subject or a sample is telling us. Okay, so to overcome all this, the research tool has to be objective. So it controls for all the extraneous variables. It overcomes the bias and makes the research bias free. So if a research is very objective in nature, then it has more value. If bias plays a role, if the research is not objective, then it has less value. Okay, the next aspect of a research tool is a practicability. Practicability means how practical is the research tool for you to do the research. Okay, so it should be easily used. Suppose you have 10,000 questions in a questionnaire, it is not easy for a person to use it. There will be 100 pages or more than that. So that means it is difficult to administer the test for each patient. So if you have 200 patients in your research study, then 10,000 questions 200 patients have to answer means you have to multiply the time and the cost and the effort that is involved, and then you have to type all the answers in the computer for you to analyze it. So this makes it very difficult for you to give a test. So ease of administration, simple time, all this should be kept in mind when you do a research and select a tool. Then the ease of scoring. Suppose you give 0.25 marks or 0.5 marks for each correct answer, then you say I will deduct 1 mark for each negative answer, then it becomes very difficult for you to calculate the right and the wrong and the whole score that the patient is getting. Instead you can say correct answer will get 1 mark, wrong answer will get 0 marks. This is an easy way of scoring the answers which patients give in the tool. then the interpretation should also be easy. Okay, so once the research has been done and you have collected the data, you have to interpret it in the right way. And finally, the economy, that is, it has to be cost effective. You cannot, like I said in the previous example, if it's a 10,000 questions in one questionnaire, then imagine the time that is taken and the cost of zero photocopying all these pages of questions. And for each patient, you will have to photocopy one sample or one copy of the questionnaire. That will cost a lot of money for the researcher. So economy should also be considered. Same way, as in the previous example of objectivity, there is an example which says, if you want to study the effects of a riot, then you cannot create a riot. Okay, once a riot happens, you can use the results for your study, but you cannot create a riot because it is ethically unviable, economically unviable. So these are factors that you have to consider when you use a research tool: the practicability, the objectivity, reliability, validity. All these are important factors. Okay, so now we'll go to the next chapter, which is tools of data collection. So what are the tools of data collection? There are different tools that can be used by you for a data collection. So when you do a research study with patients or other samples, you have to collect data. So what are the tools that are commonly used? One is a paper questionnaire. That is, questionnaire is typed out and printed on a paper which is given out to the samples who fill it and give. Or you can have a computer questionnaire. That is, the interview is done by the computer. There is a questionnaire. Now you have Google Forms and other forms which are available on the internet that can be used for data collection. Then there are other methods of data collection like case studies, checklists, interviews, observation, and surveys or questionnaires. Okay, these are all various tools that can be used. We will be seeing most of this in detail, like observation, interview, checklist, all that we are going to study in detail. So what are the criteria for selection of tools? So when you select a tool, there should be some criteria. Otherwise, you won't know which tool is the best and which one to select for your study. So let us see the various criteria for selection of tools. The first criteria is the nature of your study. Okay, what kind of study that you are doing? If you are doing a study which is collecting the knowledge of nurses, okay, then you can give a questionnaire. Same way, if you are doing a study which is trying to find about the attitude of a person, then a questionnaire will not be able to assess the attitude. You have to have a Likert scale, okay, which is a scale which we will be seeing later. So Likert scale would be better in understanding the attitude of a person. So based on this, what kind of study you're doing, whether it's a knowledge scale, whether knowledge, testing the knowledge or testing the attitude. So based on what type of study you're doing, you have to select the tool. Sometimes if you're studying both knowledge and attitude, you can have a questionnaire to check the knowledge and a Likert scale to check the attitude. So this way you can select the tools. The next thing is the type of research subjects. Okay, why is this important? Because sometimes some patients are illiterate. So if they are illiterate, you cannot give out a questionnaire and tell them to fill it. You have to use methods like interview methods so that you can ask the same questions which are available in the questionnaire. So the type of research subjects is very important, and based on their ability or inability to do a give you data, you have to decide on the type of data collection. For example, again, a physically disabled person or a mentally challenged person, they cannot fill in questionnaires. So you have to use observation. You just have to observe their behavior and talk to them. So you can use interview or observation as method. So your data collection tool will depend on the type of research subjects. Next is the type of research study. See whether you are using a qualitative study or a quantitative study. Qualitative study means you have to use focus group discussion, interviews. All these will help you to gather data which is relevant in a qualitative study, and these kind of data will be in running hand. You have to record it and then type it out. Like some patients may say, I feel happy when I see my parents, or I feel sad when I'm caught in a disaster. So these are all attitudes which have to be written down, which are qualitative statements. These are not quantities which you can just, you cannot say the person was 5% happy to see his parents, or you cannot say the person was 10% unhappy when the cyclone came and 20% unhappy when the tsunami came. So these kind of things are not possible. So qualitative research, you have to have statements, okay? And in a quantitative research, you can collect data which is in number form. You can find out the educational qualification, 10th or 12th or BSc or masters. So these kind of data you can quantitate. So based on the type of research that you are doing, you have to use a particular type of data collection. Then the next criteria for selecting a research tool is the purpose of your research study. Okay, based on the purpose of your research study, you can use different types of data collection methods. Like you can use in-depth interviews for some researchers, or you can even do a literature study. You can just use the data which is already available, like secondary data we said, okay, which is already available on the internet. You can use that for a research study. So the purpose of the research study is important for you to decide which tool you are going to use. Then the size of the study sample. See, if you have 10,000 people in your study, then you have to use a simple method like a Google online questionnaire, so that everybody, you send it and they fill it and send it. It's very easy and saves a lot of time. But if you use the 10,000 people and you are going to interview each of them personally, then even if you interview two people in a day, it will take 5,000 days. That is many years. Okay, so based on the size of the study sample, you have to decide which method of data collection you will use. Okay, similarly, similar to the size, the distribution of the population. See, if they are living all over the country of India, then you have to travel to each place to interview them. So if they are spread out over a large geographical area, it is easier for you to send questionnaires by email or send messages through phone and collect the data instead of visiting the person. So the distribution of target population also plays a role in the type of data collection that you do. And one more thing is the time frame of the study. Okay, based on the time frame for your study, you can use different data tools. Okay, if you have to do a study within 5 days, then you have to use appropriate methods so that you can finish the study in 5 days. If you have 6 months for you to do the study, then you can use different methods. See, a lot of people from other countries come to Karigiri and they do their school projects and college projects within 5 days or 1 month or 2 weeks. So that's a very short time for them to do data collection. So they use methods in which they will be able to collect data within that short frame of time. Okay, so they don't use methods which are very difficult and time taking. They use structured questionnaire, which is a very short questionnaire which can be given to the target sample population, and they get the data within a short time. Okay, so the time frame of the study, if you do a large study for your third year final year project and you have 1 year to complete the project, then you can use a in-depth different method which takes a lot of time. Okay, then the literacy levels of the subject. The first point itself, when we were talking about the questionnaire, I was telling about the literacy level of the subject. Illiterate people who cannot fill in questionnaires, or they need help in filling questionnaires, then if somebody else is filling the questionnaire, there can be bias. So better would be interviews, so that they understand what you are asking. Similarly, the questions that you ask should be in the native language, so that they'll be able to understand the question and they can answer also properly. So the literacy levels of the subjects decide what type of data collection method and what tool you use in your research subject. And the last two points are the availability of resources and manpower. See, if five people are doing data collection for one research project, then you have a lot of manpower. And if you are rich people, if you have a lot of money for the research, if it's a funded project, then you can use a part of the money for data collection purposes. But if you are a college student and you are using your own money and you are only one person doing a study, then you have to use methods which are economical, where you do not need to spend a lot of money, and you also have to use methods which are less time taking. So based on this, you can use whether observation or interviews or questionnaires. Usually students in a BSc college use a one page questionnaire or a two page questionnaire, and based on that they finish their research study. But if it's a funded project, you can use the resource for a in-depth detailed study which will carry more value. And finally, the researcher's knowledge level and competence. See, if you do not know what is a focus group discussion, then you will not use it as a research tool. If you know only about questionnaires, you will use only questionnaires in your research tool. For example, in our college, I've seen that most students use questionnaires because you find it is easy. You just have to create the questions, give it to 10 people, collect the data, and then analyze it and publish your findings. Whereas if you do use other methods, it may be more relevant and it may be more beneficial for you to do the research. So based on your skill, your competence level, your understanding, and how much time you have, all these factors also play a role in deciding which research tool you want to or which data collection tool you want to use for data collection in your research. Okay, I hope you understood all these factors which play a major role in selecting the type of tool that you will use in a research study. Okay, as I said, most students use questionnaires, but they are not the only methods of collecting data. You can do an interview, though it is time taking. You can have a focus group discussion where you have a group of people with similar problems and you can discuss their problems. And you can also use methods like Likert scale to check the attitude of the person. Okay, so these are all different methods of data collection, and you can use any of these tools for your data collection. Some of the factors that we have discussed in this topic will restrict you from using certain tools. Like you have probably 4 months to 6 months for data collection in final year, so you have to use methods which will help you to collect the data within that period of time. So based on your time, your knowledge, the patient's knowledge, the patient's understanding, the manpower available, so all these factors play a role in deciding or selecting the research tool and the data collection tool. Okay, I hope you understood this topic. We will next see each of the different types of tools that are part of your syllabus, that is mainly the observation, interview, questionnaire, and checklist. These four things we will be looking at in detail in the coming days. Okay, thank you.